This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. First up on Dreamland, we have a very special and very exciting guest. You'll hear more in a moment. Then we're going in a different direction. Dreamland rarely goes into the area of entertainment, but this time we're going to go into Star Trek country. I know a lot of you out there are Trekkies. You love Star Trek. I love Star Trek. So we're going to talk to Star Trek mega fans, Mark Cushman and Vic Mignogna, who have created a Star Trek fan series that is dynamite on YouTube. You'll find out all about it in a few minutes. But first, well, the man is a living legend, a legend in his own time. Eric von Daniken, author of Chariots of the Gods, and a major figure in the whole controversy about what our past is really was really like and what happened. Eric is going to be at Contact in the Desert, May the 31st to June the 2nd in Indian Wells, California. And Eric, first, welcome to Dreamland.
Well, I'm sitting in Switzerland. It's blue sky, wonderful weather. The mountains are full with snow. I enjoy it.
Well, good. Well, here I am in cloudy California, Southern California. It's cool and cloudy here on the Pacific Shore. What an amazing thing. I mean, to think of the fact that we're chatting together like this across such a vast distance, and it's so easy. It's amazing, isn't it?
I'm happy that our technology makes all these things possible, and technology will make more things possible, which we think today are impossible.
Now, your lecture is going to be The Gods Were Astronauts, which has been something of a theme of your life, I think.
Yes, definitely.
Definitely, right, absolutely. Anyway, you make reference in the blurb about the lecture about a cuneiform from Sumer that confirms the visit of extraterrestrials. Could you give us just a brief idea of what you're going to be talking about?
Well, I have several speeches there, and generally it's all about, have we been visited by beings from outer space in the deep past, and how can we prove this? To answer briefly, we have until today no objective proof. I have never found an object which definitely and proudly I will present to the scientific community and say, this object is not from our planet, it's from somewhere else. We don't have this. But we have a proof by indication. And I know what I'm talking about. I have published now 41 books on the subject. Indications means, for example, old writings. You just mentioned it, cuneiform writings. In Germany, we have a professor in Sumerology. His name is Burgard. And he had the courage to make translations of old cuneiform texts into modern terms, with modern eyes. What does that mean? For example, we know in the past, in the holy literature, we have figures like angels. Now, angels, we think angels are the good ones. They are described with halos, with helmets. They are the helpers of God. Now, he found out that these angels were not only the good ones. Angels had fights. They were fighting in the so-called heaven, including in our own Christian Jewish tradition. Lucifer is fighting against the Almighty God. So translate the word angel into extraterrestrial, and then you change the whole meaning. Or we have a word like heaven. When I was a boy, I was taught, when I die, and when I've been correct in my life, I would go into heaven. Heaven is the place of happiness. In heaven, you are united with the Almighty God. Later, I learned, and this in cuneiform, and this in different mythology, that heaven was a place of fighting, of war. There were wars in heaven, not only in cuneiform writings, also in the old Sumerian texts, in different mythologies. So change the word heaven into space. Now I have changed two words. I took angels and make extraterrestrials. I took heaven and changed it into space. If I do this with 10 words, with 10 keywords, I changed the whole meaning, and that's what I'm going to talk in Contact with the Desert.
Oh, boy, that sounds great. I really enjoy your lectures there. They're very stimulating. I mean, because, you know, we we don't, our past simply doesn't add up. There are many other indications out there that something is missing. You mentioned, for example, wars, and of course the Vedas record an interstellar war of some kind.
Absolutely. We really can prove this. And it's not just fantasy. It's not just imagination. You know, humans always had imagination. They were dreaming of flying, being like birds and whatever. But some of these texts are too clear. Give me a short example. There is a book called The Book of Enoch. Now, I don't go into details. Enoch was taken away by he called it the guardians of the sky. In my eyes, extraterrestrials. He learns the language of the extraterrestrials. Then they teach him writing. And then he has teachers. And one of the teachers says to Enoch, "Human, look out of the window. Do you see this little light out there? You humans call it moon. But the moon has no light by itself. The moon receives its light from the sun." And then he explains him the different phases of the moon. Why is the moon sometimes full, then half, and disappears, etc.? The same thing he explains with our calendar. He says that we are on the planet surrounding our sun in 365 days plus leak hours. So these are scientific informations which you cannot dream. So we have to look at some of the old texts with modern eyes.
Eric von Daniken, this is going to be a wonderful weekend, and with you especially, it's going to be great, and I'm so happy that you spent some time with us on Dreamland, a little time, not too much time, because, you know, obviously we want to hear you at Contact. Contact in the Desert, May the 31st to June the 2nd, Indian Wells, California. Google contactinthedesert.com. You can't miss it. Eric, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland.
Thank you. It was a pleasure to speak to you and an honor. Goodbye.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
And now it's time to boldly go where no man has ever gone before. Beam up with me to the deck of the Starship Enterprise. We're going on a voyage into the world of Star Trek with Mark Cushman and Vic Mignogna. We have two people with us who are deeply involved in Star Trek, and there's some new stuff out there. Mark has got a... Well, let me let you guys tell us about it. First, both of you, welcome to Dreamland.
Hi, Whitley.
Hello. How are you, Mark and Vic?
Hello, Whitley, it's here with you, and Mark, always a pleasure.
Okay. Now, I have never done a show like this before. I am familiar with the old, old Star Trek from the Dark Ages, I suppose. I didn't get into Star Trek The Next Generation, but I did look at your wonderful fan series, Vic, on the internet, and it was so cool. Just beautiful stuff. And folks, you can find this by going to www.StarTrekContinues.com.
Thank you, Whitley.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. About 6 years ago, when I was a little boy, 10, 11, 12, I fell in love with the original series, then several decades later, after spending years developing skills in filmmaking and acting and sound and music and production, I decided about 6 years ago that I wanted to make an episode of the original series, basically just to pay tribute to the show that I loved and inspired me so much when I was young. So I brought a bunch of my friends together, and we rebuilt the entire soundstage from the classic series, which is still standing right now in Georgia. And we made an episode, and we put it out on the internet, didn't know how people would respond, and they really, really enjoyed it. So we proceeded to make 11 full-length episodes, everyone better than the last. Mark even wrote the screenplay for episode 5. And our series picks up where the original Star Trek was canceled in the late 60s, and it takes the audience right up to the end of the 5-year mission and leaves all of the characters where they were when Star Trek the Motion Picture came out in the late 70s.
Well, it's really very impressively done. Beautiful sets and well acted and very well written. I was absolutely amazed. I didn't even know it was out there. So,
well, Whitley, I hope you'll watch all of them.
Well, I will.
I'm sure you're a busy man, but I can promise you every episode gets better and better and better than the last, as with probably any TV series where you're kind of, trying to get in your stride and getting to know everybody and working out the kinks. But
right.
All of the stories are compelling morality plays of ethical questions and social issues, very much like the original Star Trek.
Yeah.
And by the way, Whitney, this is Mark. My favorite isn't the one I wrote. It's pretty good. But my favorite is Fairest of Them All, which is a sequel to Mirror Mirror from the original series, which was a great episode of the original series where Kirk and his landing party beam up to the Enterprise, but they end up in an alternate universe on an alternate Enterprise, and Spock's got a goatee, and promotion is through assassination and all this stuff. And that episode ended where Kirk gets away from that Enterprise, and the bad Kirk, who was being held on the real Enterprise, is being back to his Enterprise. Anyway, Vic had a great idea. He thought, I always wondered what happened when the bad Kirk came back to his ship after the good Kirk had planted seeds with Mr. Spock, that every revolution starts with one person. You don't have to have an evil empire like this. And so he did an episode called Fairest of Them All, which picks up right where Mirror Mirror left off. And we did a screening where we showed Mirror Mirror, then took a break so everybody could go out and have a cigarette or go to the bathroom or chat or whatever, and then they came back into the auditorium, a couple hundred people in there, and the lights dimmed. We brought it up with Fairest of Them All, and there was a gasp throughout the room. Because as you just observed, Whitney, it's the same sets, the same lighting, music that sounds like it came right from that show, a professional cast. You even got Chris Doohan, James Doohan's son, playing Scotty, and he looks like Scotty, and he sounds like Scotty. And so it was really like they changed out the actors, but they still feel like the original actors, and the story continues. And so I recommend that you go on Hulu or wherever you have to go and watch the Mirror Mirror, and then go over to StarTrekContinues.com and watch Fairest of Them All. And you're going
to
have an amazing 90-minute experience.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, Mark. Thank you.
Well, it's very exciting stuff. We have to take a little break right now for our Free Dreamlanders. So Free Dreamlanders, take a voyage through these announcements and land on every one of them. We'll be right back.
Did you know that the Unknown Country newsletter is absolutely free and comes to you by email once a week? The newsletter has been published since 2000, and in all that time, not one subscriber has ever received a single piece of spam because they were on our list. But what they have received week in and week out is the very latest from unknowncountry.com, including a Dreamland preview and all the latest news. Go to unknowncountry.com and sign up today. You owe it to yourself, and it's free.
The Afterlife Revolution is getting great reviews. There's a tremendous, lovely response to it, and I'm so pleased and humbled because it's an effort on the part of myself and Anne. And I love Anne so much. I want her to succeed in this incredible task that she has undertaken of returning and communicating across the bridge between the worlds. And she's really doing it. It is this is a real thing that's happening. Listen to some of these reviews. Anne and Whitley Strieber lay out their life's work in the most exquisitely beautiful manner. This moving book comes from the heart, the unified heart of two people who have dedicated their lives in this realm and the next to revealing the nature of consciousness as it makes its sojourn in this human form. That's just one. Here's another. I love, love this book. It's a wonderful read, especially if you lost somebody very close to you. Just incredible. Here's another one. The book shows you how to grow your soul, for lack of a better term. Through Anne's insight, Whitley shares invaluable information that could only be from the other side. So take it seriously. Go to Amazon and get Afterlife Revolution. Go on to Amazon and get the Afterlife Revolution in paperback or in Kindle format. And if you have questions or thoughts, write me at whitley@strieber.com. I'm right here. I'm ready to answer anything you ask to help you in any way I can, always. We're talking to Vic Mignon. Help me with
Mignana.
Your name. Mignana.
Mignana.
Okay, I'll try to remember. Vic Mignana, like as in manana. Okay.
Right,
Vic Mignana and Mark Cushman about Star Trek and their long experience with it. Mark has got a book out called These Are the Voyages, Gene Roddenberry and Star Trek in the 1970s. And now an audio book. Can you tell us a little bit about this audio book?
Yeah, and yeah. I'll let Vic talk mostly about that. I'll set it up for him. I did a three-book series a couple years ago. The first one came out in 2013, then 2014, then 2015. And we won a Saturn Award for this this series as Literary Achievement of the Year when the third one came out for all three books. And what they are is they document the making of the original Star Trek, a book for each season, a chapter for each episode. And Gene Roddenberry got me started on this. And he gave me access to all the show files. And we're talking tens of thousands of pieces of paper, all the memos, the shooting schedules, the budgets, my publisher license, all the ratings from A.C. Nielsen for every episode. And so what happens is as you read each episode, you go through the process of them writing the script, producing it, it being aired and seeing how many people were watching and the reviews that came in and everything else. And the fun thing for a Star Trek fan is they can read all that in about 15 pages and then sit down and watch the episode, and they're seeing it in a whole new light. And I had the help of Gene Roddenberry, his co-producer Bob Justman, associate producer John D.F. Black, who's the guy who came up with the word space, the final frontier, story editor Dorothy Fontana. I mean, all these people came forward and cooperated with these books, and they include these memos. So it's really a remarkable journey. Anyway, we won that award, and then Vic, who's a terrific voiceover artist, and as you mentioned in the previous segment, plays Captain Kirk in Star Trek Continues. He's now done an audiobook based on season one, the first of these three volumes. And before I hand it over to you, Vic, the book you were mentioning, Whitley is Star Trek, Gene Roddenberry. These Are the Voyages, Star Trek, Gene Roddenberry, and Star Trek in the 1970s. And this picks up the story now after the cancelization of the series, takes us through that first essential decade when Star Trek came back into popularity, was dominating the ratings and syndication. The conventions were starting up. The merchandising was going crazy. They made the animated series, and they made the first motion picture, and they aborted Phase 2 series. So all that's covered in this new book. Anyway, over to you, Vic. Audiobook.
Yeah, well, tell us about it.
Whitley, as Mark mentioned, I've been a voice actor for about 20 years. I've voice acted in more than 300 different animated series and video games. And, of course, Star Trek is my childhood passion. So when Mark and his publishing company, Jacobs Brown Press, approached me and said, you know, you would really be the perfect person to do this audiobook because you're a big Star Trek fan and you're a voiceover actor and you created this award-winning web series. You seem like the perfect fit. And so I was really excited, especially as a Star Trek fan, Whitley, because let me tell you about these books. They are so comprehensive and you learn things about the behind-the-scenes making of these iconic episodes that even as a fan, you may never have known, like the struggles and the challenges that they had to overcome to get a certain thing, a certain shot or a certain episode done, or problems with actors or problems with the network or problems with writers or, you know, all of these different hurdles and challenges just to get these things made, and decisions that they made at the spur of the moment, which were out of necessity, that have now become literally part of our planetary vernacular, like things that are commonplace in our culture now, and where they were conceived of and how they came to be, whether it was beam me up, Scotty, or phasers, or, and you know, so many things about Star Trek that people just know, and to learn about how it all came about and the people that helped make it. And when I started this audiobook, I started thinking, well, it would be so much more fun to listen to if it were not just me. You know, most audiobooks you buy, it's one narrator, right? And he'll change his voice occasionally to be the different characters. But in These Are the Voyages, there are literally hundreds of characters quoted, people quoted. And it became clear to me that I couldn't, you know, change my voice to be hundreds of different people. And then I thought it would be more fun if I brought other people into it and let them play the roles of these iconic personalities, like bring someone in to be the voice of Gene Roddenberry and bring someone in to be the voice of Leonard Nimoy, who is passed, of course. Well, who do you think I got? Adam Nimoy, his son.
Wow.
His dad's roles, his dad's quotes. And Chris Doohan voices his dad's quotes. And Dorothy Fontana, who was actually there, and Joe DiAgosta, and Clint Howard, and Bobby Clark, and Sean Kinney, and all of these people that were actually there, as well as 60 or 70 other people, friends of mine from Star Trek Continues, cast and crew people from my show, all participate, so that when you listen to this, Whitley, you feel like you're actually listening to the people that were there, and you feel like you're sitting in a room listening to them in their own words describe what was going on or the challenge that they faced in this or that particular episode. It's really, even people that have read the books have listened to the audiobook and they're like, it's like hearing it all over again. It's very, very entertaining.
Sounds like a lot of fun. It really does.
It really is. It's a lot of fun. And like I said, feeling like you're actually listening to the people involved in making the show.
I can tell you how much fun it is, Whitley and Vic. You know, when they sent over the first chapter for me to listen to, just so I could see how it was coming together, I thought, oh, I'll listen to a minute or two. But I wrote the book. You know, I'm not going to sit here for an hour and listen to this thing, because it's 27 hours long, the entire audio play. That's what I call it, an audio play. And so I started listening to it, and I just couldn't get up. I couldn't stop. It was, even though I knew a lot of the stuff, I've forgotten some of the things because it's been a couple of years now, but I wrote the book, I knew all this stuff, I'm familiar with the material, but I could not stop listening to it because it was so entertaining, the way Vic put this thing together. And to hear DC Fontana reading her memos from 1966 and 67, and what they did, Whitley, is with every script, including ones that didn't get produced, and it's all covered, Bob Justman, Gene Roddenberry, Gene Kuhn, Dorothy Fontana, John Black, and Stan Robertson from NBC would send memos back to each other on the stories and the scripts as they were developed. And so by having snippets of all these memos in there, you feel like you're sitting in the room listening to all of them discuss this week's show as they're putting it together. And then to go watch the show is really kind of a trip.
Yeah, it is. It's really amazing. And some of the people that I brought in, Whitley, I brought in the equivalent from my series to voice personalities from the original series. For instance, Jerry Finnerman is a name that most people don't know unless you're a big, big, hardcore classic Star Trek fan. But Jerry Finnerman was the director of photography on the original series of Star Trek. He is the one that's responsible for all of that classic, you know, iconic lighting. And who do you think I had voice the excerpts of Jerry Finnerman? None other than Matt Busey, my director of photography for Star Trek Continues. So I was able to use a lot of my cast and crew. Grant Imahara, who plays Sulu from Mythbusters, who plays Sulu in my series, voices his character. And, you know, so many wonderful people involved in it. It's so much fun to listen to.
Well, that's just great. I can hardly wait to start on it. I was so impressed by the episode that I watched. And, you know, you say it gets better. I watched the first episode, and it really is very, very good.
Oh, my goodness. Can I tell you something?
Sure.
I watched the first episode in a public setting a couple of weeks ago with some people that had never seen our series. And they were all, you know, their jaws were hanging open, and they were all just enthralled with it. And I was sitting there going, oh, my gosh, this is so hard to watch, because we got so much better with every episode that it was kind of actually difficult for me to watch the first episode, because we were still experimenting and we had all come together for the first time and, you know, kind of figuring out what we were doing. But I hope, Whitley, genuinely, that you'll stay with it and watch the entire series, because it'll blow your mind. It'll really blow your mind. It's iconic. We did what was never done. The original Star Trek, most people don't even realize this. You know, at the beginning of every show, Kirk used to say, these are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. It's a five-year mission to explore strange new worlds, right? Well, they didn't have a five-year mission. They were canceled in their third year of television, and then they just disappeared with no ending to the five-year mission, and the next time you saw those characters was in Star Trek The Motion Picture 10 years later, and by that time, Kirk had become an admiral and Spock had gone back to Vulcan and everybody had gone their own separate ways. And our series does what was never done. It finishes the five-year mission, returns the Enterprise to Earth, and explains in a very compelling story how all of those characters got to be where they were when the motion picture picked them up.
So, why, and either one of you can answer this, or in fact, why don't you both take a crack at it, maybe starting with you, Mark. Why did the series end? Was it just a ratings decline? Because it seemed like such an iconic part of our lives.
You know, Whitley, one of the reasons I wrote these books, and Gene Roddenberry and Bob Justman in particular were so supportive, which is why on the front cover, the first volume, it says the story Gene Roddenberry and Robert H. Justman wanted you to know. They gave me all the memos, and they said, please share these with the fans. Find a way. You know, it's 45 boxes, big boxes. How are you going to find a way? It couldn't all go into one book. So it had to be three books, three 700-page books, which is why Vic's audiobook for season one is 27 hours long. Which flies by. I mean, it's just great to listen to. It's like you could binge on it. It's like watching a miniseries. But the show did much better than we were told. There's so much folklore out there. It was actually NBC's top-rated Thursday night show during its first season. The first episode got a 47% audience share. Can you imagine today? 47% of the TVs in
America. It's inconceivable.
Yeah, and so they moved it to Friday nights because NBC wanted to try to get rid of it, and they thought they would alienate the audience. So they moved it over there. It was still NBC's top-rated Friday night show, yet they tried to cancel it. And they got over 1 million protest letters. People were marching on NBC Burbank and NBC Rockefeller Center in New York. And so they brought it back for a third year, but they put it in the death slot, Fridays at 10 p.m. And guess what? The first episode, the notorious Spock's Brain, that kicked off the third season, beat all of its competition. It beat the two-hour premiere of Hawaii Five-0, which then ran for 12 years. And it beat Judd for the Defense, which just won an Emmy as Outstanding Dramatic Series from the previous season. So, you know, the ratings came down with each of these bad time slots, but it was still performing well. The reason it got canceled, and so we license all the ratings reports, so they're all in there. You can see the numbers. But the reason it got canceled was because it was too controversial. Gene Roddenberry was butting heads with NBC on every single episode. And maybe Vic can come in and tell you about something like The Enemy Within, since he recorded that, and he knows what happened on that particular episode that upset NBC so terribly.
Right.
And so it was these battles that NBC wanted actually to get an Irwin Allen show on, because Irwin did what the networks asked him to do. And Gene Roddenberry fought the networks tooth and nail on everything.
Yeah. Yeah. One thing that I learned, Whitley, about the series early on, and a lot of people don't realize this, and Mark's books go into it in depth, Star Trek was extremely expensive to make. And I was struck by, a lot of people don't know this, but Star Trek was made by the studio Desilu, which was Desi Arnaz and Lucille Ball's studio. And they were married, and they bought the old, what was it, RKO?
Yes.
Mark, they bought the old RKO studio, and they made Desilu. And then Lucy and Desi divorced, and Lucy kept the studio. And she told her board of directors, go find me some really cool, out-of-the-box, fresh TV shows for us to produce to put Desilu on the map. And they came back to her with two shows, Mission Impossible and Star Trek. And do you know, Whitley, that her board, they made the first pilot, and Lucille Ball's board of directors sat down with her in a boardroom and said, don't make this show. It's too expensive. It will bankrupt your studio. Don't make this show. Because think about it, Whitley, most of the shows on television in the 60s were either cop shows or westerns.
Right.
And once you build a western set, you know, and you have your costumes, you're done.
Yeah, or you and a lot of them were made just out in the desert east of LA,
and
if you look at them closely, basically the different towns in the different westerns are just paint jobs.
Exactly. Right. And the same with cop shows. It's present-day sets, it's present-day clothing, it's existing locations and police cars and uniforms. But think about it. Star Trek, every week you've got new sets, new characters, new aliens, new ships, special effects that Westerns and cop shows never had to deal with. So from the very get-go, they knew that Star Trek was going to be very expensive to make. And when you couple the expense of the show with Roddenberry's constant controversy, like Mark said.
Yeah, we have to take a break now for Free Dreamlanders. And we're going to get back. We'll talk a little bit about what was so upsetting to NBC about these episodes. We'll be right back.
War Day is one of Whitley Strieber's most powerful books. Join him and his co-author Jim Konietka as they travel across the United States devastated by limited nuclear war. This acclaimed novel was originally published in the 1980s, but now that North Korea has said that they can hit the U.S. with nukes, it's more timely than ever. Don't miss this informative, exciting, and convincing testament to the power of the human spirit in challenging times like our own. Get the ebook for $3.99. Go to Strieber.com for this and all of Whitley's great books.
Are you a close encounter witness? Then Free has something to offer you, and it is absolutely free. Listen as Free organizer Ray Hernandez explains what is available.
The Dr. Edgar Mitchell Foundation for Research into Extraterrestrial Encounters, or FREE, is a not-for-profit academic research institute established by the late Apollo astronaut Dr. Edgar Mitchell, Harvard astrophysicist Dr. Rudy Shield, and various PhD scientists and lay researchers. Free is researching what is consciousness. In other words, what is the true nature of our multidimensional reality? By undertaking cross-comparative research on individuals that are having various types of contact with non-human intelligence. To participate in Free's research study and to learn more about their various support and educational programs, please visit their website at experiencer.org. That is experiencer.org. Thank you.
We're talking to Vic Mignogna and Mark Cushman about Star Trek. You can find more by going to StarTrekContinues.com. Watch their wonderful series. You can go to MarkCushman.com to find out what Mark is up to, and you can get his book through us. Plus, there's a marvelous, marvelous new audio book as well. So there's an awful lot going on. Now, before we left the air, I was just about to ask the question, what was all of this trouble that Gene Roddenberry was having with NBC?
Well, Mark mentioned...
I'll get started now.
Yeah, go ahead, Mark, you start.
To finish up what Vic was mentioning before, a lot of people didn't know this. Lucille Ball did lose her studio. She didn't listen to the board of directors. They said, don't make the show. NBC said the first pilot was too cerebral. They came back and wanted another pilot that was more action-adventure-oriented. So they made the second one, Where No Man Has Gone Before. And the board of directors said, don't do it. We just spent almost $700,000 making the first one, which would be like $7 million today for a small studio that made situation comedies. It was killing them. And yet she said, no, we got to do this. And because she wanted another show that had the potential of rerunning for decades like I Love Lucy did. And she just had a sense that this could do it. And so they made the second pilot, cost about $450,000. And then they made the series, which cost around $200,000 per episode in that first year.
Which is enormous in those days.
A ton of money. And the networks were only giving them around $100,000 per episode. So with each episode they made, they were going $100,000 into debt, back when $100,000 was like $1 million.
Right.
So by halfway through the second season of Star Trek, Lucy had to sell Desilu Productions to Paramount Pictures, and they took it over. Because she went broke. The board of directors was right, and it broke her heart. And then Paramount, the first thing they did is cut the budgets. They said, you're not going to destroy us like you destroyed Desilu. So that's what happened there. As far as the stories, and Vic and I can trade off on this, that upset them. If you think about Star Trek, for any of your listeners who are familiar with the first series, this is the mid-60s and late 60s. And back then, you weren't supposed to talk about hot topic subjects on TV. That was for the news division, not the entertainment division. And they were doing stories on sexism, racism, God, the Vietnam War. I mean, they had an episode where people were half white and half black, which was so much about racial disharmony in this country. They did an episode called A Private Little War, which was totally about the Vietnam War. They did an episode called The Enemy Within, where Kirk is divided in two by the transporter. And there's the good side and the bad side, which is a primal side, an animal side. And he tries to rape his yeoman, and he's on top of her, trying to rape her. And NBC, in these memos you read in the book and that Vic reads in the audiobook, they said, this cannot be played as a rape. And Roddenberry writes back, and you see the memo, and he says, no, he's just going to get forward with her. If you know that episode, he's on top of her. He's trying to rape her. And this is in 1966, and the ratings, we have the ratings for every half hour of every episode, and it was winning its time slot, and it dropped to number 3 the minute that rapes happened. And then there's a memo in there from NBC, Stan Robertson, saying, we will never rerun this episode. Don't ever do this to us again. This is the kind of stuff they were fighting about, and this is why NBC wanted to get rid of the show. It was too much trouble for them and too expensive for the studio.
Okay, we're going to take a brief break, Free Dreamlanders, and soon we will be in the new website, folks, and you will be able to subscribe to UnknownCountry.com again.
War Day is one of Whitley Strieber's most powerful books. Join him and his co-author Jim Konietka as they travel across the United States devastated by limited nuclear war. This acclaimed novel was originally published in the 1980s, but now that North Korea has said that they can hit the U.S. with nukes, it's more timely than ever. Don't miss this informative, exciting, and convincing testament to the power of the human spirit in challenging times like our own. Get the ebook for $3.99. Go to Strieber.com for this and all of Whitley's great books. Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to the Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
We're back. We're talking to Vic Mignogna and Mark Cushman. Vic's websites, vicsworld.net, StarTrekContinues.com, where you will find a terrific extension of Star Trek. Really, really well done. Mark's website is markcushman.com. Mark has an extraordinary book out about Star Trek, These Are the Voyages, and there is also a new audio book, which is quite fascinating. If you're interested in Star Trek, you are at the right place. Now, before we left the air, we're beginning to talk about some of the controversies involved. And Vic, I wonder if you've got anything to add along those lines, the controversies.
Mark was really thorough about what he mentioned, and he's right on the money, of course, that the reason that Star Trek had and Roddenberry had such a difficult time was because he was pushing the envelope of standards and standards and practices back in the day, you know, back in the day of Leave It to Beaver, you know, and Hazel and Father Knows Best. And, you know, all these kind of really wholesome shows, there weren't a lot of people pushing the envelope, and Roddenberry was one of them. He didn't want to just make sci-fi stories. He didn't want to make stories about space aliens. He wanted to make stories about the human condition and about ethical questions and moral dilemmas and social issues. And the episodes that Mark mentioned were some of those that were constantly butting heads with the network. And of course, there were others. Like, there was an episode called Plato's Stepchildren, where the very first ever interracial kiss took place between William Shatner, Captain Kirk, and Nichelle Nichols, Lieutenant Uhura. And you know what's interesting, though, and I want to cap this particular question off by saying this: it's interesting that the very thing that made these episodes so controversial ultimately probably got them canceled because of Roddenberry pushing the way he did, I would dare say, are the very reasons why we're still talking about Star Trek 55 years later.
Boy, it's amazing it's been that long.
You know what I mean? The stories are timeless. The stories are about moral questions and ethical questions and social questions that we struggle with even today. So it's interesting to note that the very things that caused so much trouble in the 60s and ultimately maybe even contributed to getting the series canceled is the very thing that made the series so enduring and so topical even today.
Mark, what drew you to this in the first place?
Star Trek, more than any other show, was the series that made me want to become a television writer. There were others. I loved the Dick Van Dyke Show, where he played a TV writer, and I thought, oh, that seems like a fun gig in a room all day with Buddy and Sally making jokes. But Star Trek, because of the messages, and it was so entertaining, but every time an episode was over, And I was watching this when I was 10. I would lie in bed and be thinking about it because there was more information than just entertainment, as we just discussed, to where you learn things about us, the human race, by looking at us through a Vulcan or through other aliens, something the other sci-fi shows weren't really doing. They were just monster stories. And so I thought, you know, I would love to do this as a living. I would love to be able to enlighten and entertain people as much as this show is doing for me. And in the in 82, I got an opportunity to interview Gene Roddenberry for a local TV station for a special on Star Trek. And I was very young, just got into town not too many years before and was trying to get started as a screenwriter. And the company I was working for sent me down to Paramount to interview him. And that, and at the end of that interview, I asked him if he had saved all the memos from all the episodes. There was a great book that came out when the show was being made called The Making of Star Trek, but it was never, you know, complete. It kind of showed how the show came together, the pilots, but it didn't show the fight that it was in episode by episode through the entire run of the show. I said, did you keep all those memos? And he said, yeah. You know, we have 45 boxes. We have all the scripts, all the story treatments. We have all the fighting memos with NBC, all the problems over the budget, the problems over censorship, you name it. And I asked him if I could put all that together in a book, and he said absolutely, that he would assist me, make himself available for interviews and so on. And it took decades because there was so much material and so many people to interview, and I was busy writing scripts. So the first book didn't actually come out until 2013, and Gene had been gone for over 10 years. And but I was interviewing all the other people who were involved in the process and so on. So to get all this information, to be able to go in there, and I'll tell you, I learned more about screenwriting from reading those memos than any screenwriting class could ever teach you.
Oh, I can imagine you would, because it takes you inside the process, and mainly inside the minds of executives who is generally terrified, is my experience of them, and struggling to get generally recalcitrant creative people who have different agendas to make something that they think the public will like.
Well, it was interesting to see them having their internal conversations through their memos about two things especially. One is Captain Kirk is the protagonist in Star Trek. He's the guy telling the stories through his captain's logs. He's got to lead the missions. He's got to be the central character in every story. Even if it seems like it's a Spock story, it's always the burden falls on Kirk's shoulders. And Roddenberry had to teach this to all these freelance writers. They kept sending in scripts, and he says, where's Kirk? Kirk's got to lead the show. Also, he would write back to them and say, what's the theme? This is very entertaining. I love the hook. But what are you trying to say with this script? And I can tell you, Whitley, that in all my years of writing scripts, I never had a producer until Gene Roddenberry, when I pitched to him for Star Trek Continues, who asked me what the theme of the story was going to be. What's it going to be about? And the only other producer I ever, and I've pitched to hundreds of producers over the decades, the only other producer who ever asked what the theme would be is Vic Mignogna.
Well, hello, Vic. Vic.
Wow, I'm in good company, apparently.
Yeah, I want to ask you a little bit about the mechanics of your series, because it got very high production values. At least it looks like that on the front end from where I'm sitting.
Yeah.
And
yes.
How do you licensed it from the rights from CBS and then how do you finance a thing like that?
Well, no, actually, there was no license at all. But if you notice, it didn't cost you anything to watch it, did it? Did you?
No, I did notice that.
Yeah, the reason is because I made this show with my friends as a love letter to Star Trek. We didn't charge any money. We didn't make any profit. It was purely a passion project for me to express my gratitude and love and appreciation for the classic series. And obviously, I'm not alone. There are millions of people out there that Star Trek, the classic Star Trek, impacted and influenced in so many ways. And so I made this show to say thank you. Now, in answer to your financial question, when I decided I wanted to make an episode, I didn't plan to make a whole series, Whitley. I wanted to make one episode. And I wanted to make it with a a theme and a message, and as much like an original Star Trek episode as I could make it. And I rented a building in South Georgia and got a bunch of people together, and I put in a bunch of my own money to rent this building and then proceed to buy all of the raw materials to build the set. And we, you know, I felt early on that if I was going to do this, that I shouldn't really ask other people to give me money for something that they had no proof whether I could do or not. And I felt like it was a quintessential case of putting your money where your mouth is. So I paid personally. I funded the building of the sets. I funded the first episode. And by funded, I mean I paid to fly to buy plane tickets for everyone, to fly to the studio. I paid to put them in hotels every night. I paid to feed them every day, and rent the gear and everything. So I single-handedly, well, me and a couple of friends, we funded the first episode. And then after we finished the first episode and we had a proof of concept, we released the episode and people really enjoyed it. Once we had something that we could point to and say, this is what we can do if you want to help us make more, that's what we did. And we started launching crowdfunding campaigns, Kickstarter, Indiegogo kind of things. And the fans generously responded. And we launched a crowdfunding campaign to make 2, 3, and 4. And then we launched another crowdfunding campaign to make episodes 5, 6, and 7. And then we launched one more campaign to make 8, 9, 10, and 11. The stories were all contributed by amazing writers, even Judy Burns, who wrote an original series episode, The Tholian Web, contacted us unsolicited and loved our series and contributed a story idea that became our 8th episode. So we've had a lot of amazing writers involved in our series, and the stories are very compelling and thought-provoking, just like the classic Star Trek was.
You also had John D.F. Black as a story editor.
Oh,
I was
goodness.
One of Vic's story editors, and John came in. Now, John D.F. Black was the story editor on the original Star Trek, its first season. And as I said earlier, he was the guy who actually came up the line, Space, the Final Frontier. So he looked over some scripts and gave notes to Vic for that as well, as Judy Burns coming in. She always wanted to do a sequel to The Tholian Web, which was a third season episode. And I was interviewing her for that book, These Are the Voyages, Season 3, which came out in 2015. And Vic must have been working on the show at that point, Vic. Did it start that early?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I turned her on to it. I said, you ought to check out the show. And she calls back and says, this is fantastic. And I said, you know, when I was interviewing you, you mentioned that if there had been a fourth season, they wanted you to do a sequel to The Tholian Web because she had a great idea for it. And I said, you know, hey, they're doing Star Trek now and Star Trek continues. So, yeah, I introduced her to Vic and she came in and wrote this thing, which is just the perfect follow-up to The Tholian Web. And it, what's funny is you may watch The Tholian Web and think, okay, it concludes. It doesn't need to continue on. But what she came up with really takes it into such an interesting place, and it makes you realize that, no, the first chapter really didn't end. It seemed like it did, but it really didn't. So that was a great, great thing for that to happen for Star Trek Continues as well.
Yeah, and when you get to that episode, Whitley, it's episode number 8, and what you're going to find with our series is that we have a wonderful mixture of completely original story ideas, and then also some sequels and follow-ups to some of the most popular classic Star Trek series.
Well, you got Michael Forrest to come back and play Apollo again.
Yes.
And now you may think, Whitley, or if your viewers know that episode, Who Mourns for Adonis, you're going to say, well, you know, he's a young, buffed, godlike guy. How can he play that part? But when you see the story they came up with and the reason why he doesn't look young anymore, it's fascinating. And so on the few times that Star Trek Continues did a continuization, they actually enriched the original episode by fleshing it out even further, taking it to the next level to where it's not exploiting the first episode at all. It's making the first episode even better when you realize where it could have gone.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And we've got, and Whitley, we've got guest stars throughout our entire series from some of the most popular TV franchises. We've got guest stars from Doctor Who, Battlestar Galactica, Star Wars, Buck Rogers, The Incredible Hulk, Buffy, Farscape, The Expanse. We've got guest stars from all kinds of great sci-fi, popular TV series that you'll see when you watch the upcoming episodes.
Well, it is great. Folks, you got to watch it. Go to StarTrekContinues.com to do that. And also, These Are the Voyages is an amazing book. If you're interested in Star Trek at all, this is like the Bible. And there is the original series season one audiobook available as well. Vic's websites are StarTrekContinues.com and VicsWorld.net. Mark's website is markcushman.com. And Mark, where can we get the audiobook?
You can get any of them. You can get the three-volume printed book set for the first series, These Are the Voyages, Seasons 1, 2, and 3, plus the new book, Star Trek and Gene Roddenberry in the 1970s. You can get them at the direct from the publisher, and they come autographed, and they can be inscribed. And they are jacobsbrownmediagroup.com. That's a lot to remember, so they also have another way to get into the website that's called theseofthevoyagesbooks.com. And that's the same place and the only place you can get the audiobook. And allsound.com as well, because that's the service that is the platform for it. But you can go to theseofthevoyagesbooks.com, and you'll find the audiobook. And let me say something really quick about that, if I may, Whitney. It's available as streaming audio right now. It is going to be available in about a month as a DVD, because if it was CD, you'd need about 25 CDs just for that first 27 hours. But apparently they can fit about that much audio on one DVD. So, you know, a lot of cars will use a DVD now, and computers can play it, and you can play it through your DVD system. But also, the nice thing about the streaming audio is you don't have to download anything. It's not taking up data on your phone or your computer. You have your own link, your own password, and you can go right to that site and listen to it and pick up listening to it where you left off. So that would be theseofthevoyagesbooks.com or jacobsbrownmediagroup.com for the audiobook or the printed books.
Okay, and you'll be able to link to those from the Dreamland page.
Oh, great.
As well, folks. It's not available on Amazon, the audiobook.
No, the printed books are, but I always tell people to get them direct from the publisher. It's the same price, and they come signed by the author, myself, and also if you want them inscribed, you can get them inscribed. Plus, Amazon's got too much money anyway.
Yeah, that's true. I publish through my own publishing company on Amazon as well, and they do take an awful lot.
Oh, they treat publishers horribly. And they pay almost no taxes, where we pay our taxes. So support the starving artist, support your country, buy from the publishers, and only get from Amazon what you have to get from Amazon.
Yeah, that's well said, well said. Now, let me ask you guys this. We recently, Eugene Roddenberry was asked about UFOs and aliens in relation to Gene, and I'm wondering if either of you can enlighten us as to what he thought about this subject. And
oh, yeah.
Yeah, go ahead then.
Well, you know, in the new book, it's a two-book set, Gene Roddenberry and Star Trek in the 1970s. And the first book covers the first half of the 70s, which includes the animated series. The second book covers Star Trek, the motion picture. But it also covers, Gene was hired by a group out of New York State to write a screenplay called The Nine. Because they were in contact with alien beings who had visited here before and were going to come back. and they wanted the world to be prepared. And they thought, well, Star Trek has helped prepare people's minds for something like this. Let's get the creator of Star Trek to write a movie that will basically introduce them back into the society so when they come, we're not shooting at them. And he spoke to a channeler, and I've got the transcripts, who basically was speaking from these aliens called the Nine, talking about who they were and when they're going to come and things of that nature. And he went in a little skeptical. Now, he believes in life on other planets, obviously. He created Star Trek. And just do the math of how many planets are out there. You know, but he wasn't sure about this. But Susan Sackett told me that his assistant, that afterwards they both became great believers in this stuff because of that experience especially.
Vic, you've got, I'm sure you've got some stuff to say about this, so go ahead and let us know what go ahead.
I do, and you know, I'm sure Mark is correct when he says, you know, that Gene obviously believed in life on other planets because he created Star Trek. But what I find fascinating is that, at least in my opinion, and Mark, you may disagree, and that's okay, but Star Trek was not about aliens. It was about humanity. You know what I mean? Like, even though it was set in space and there were a lot of other alien worlds and cultures, they were all a means to an end. And the end goal was to address the human condition. Mm-hmm. It was to discuss problems that we have here on Earth. And as we mentioned, as we touched on earlier in the interview, a lot of those subjects were taboo at the time. And so Roddenberry came to realize that the only way he was able to take on some of these topics was to set them in a far off world, in some spectacular alien planet setting.
Right. And then he could talk about controversial topics that meant something to him.
Exactly. In fact, you know what? In the very first chapter of the audio book, Gene Roddenberry talks about how much he loved Jonathan Swift, who was a very famous writer that people may or may not know, wrote the very popular story Gulliver's Travels. And what you, if you remember any teaching in literature about Jonathan Swift, he was a political satirist, and almost all of his books had very, very strong political underpinnings and undertones, but he would couch these political positions and beliefs that he had, and social issues and positions that he had in extraordinary, exciting, imaginative stories to be able to get away with making a comment about something without actually talking about it, you know, directly. And that's exactly what Roddenberry did with Star Trek.
And Rod Serling. Yeah, they both, Rod Serling used Twilight Zone and Gene Roddenberry used Star Trek to bring topics onto American TV that the American networks were opposed to at that time, even talking about them. They didn't want to get any less.
Yeah, yeah. It was interesting because it's like, okay, in Star Trek, human beings have worked out all of our problems. We've all gotten past our issues that divide us and keep us separated and keep us at each other's throats. We've gotten past it, but now let's come together and venture out into space unified as a singular humanity. And there is where we, out there is where we discover all of these things that we've already worked out in the 20th
century. Yeah, which creates the parallel stories. Whitley, do we have a minute for a 1 minute example?
Sure. We've got 10 minutes left in the show.
I mentioned some obvious ones before, like A Private Little War, which was clearly Vietnam. They did one called The Enterprise Incident, which was about the Pueblo incident, which was happening at the time they did the episode, where the Pueblo was captured by North Korea as a spy ship, and we claimed it was international waters. So Dorothy Fontana wrote a script where the Enterprise is captured by the Romulans because it crosses into their territory, and they're accused of being on a spy mission and everything else. So they were doing this. Well, here's one that I think is a great example, because you would never guess until I did the research, not only going through the memos and everything, but looking at what was happening in the news during the week that this script was being written, or they came up with the idea. There was one called Balance of Terror, where the Romulans are come across the neutral zone, and the Enterprise is chasing them. They've destroyed a couple bases on asteroids, and it's chasing them, and Kirk is told he has to encounter them before they cross over the neutral zone, because he cannot follow them across. Well, what was happening when that episode was written and made was in Vietnam. The Viet Cong were coming across the DMZ, and they would attack American bases in the south, and then they would hightail it back to their side of the line, and the American troops could chase them right up to that line, but they couldn't follow them across. And so Roddenberry and Paul Schneider, who did the script, were talking about this, and they said, "Well, let's address this issue and this debate in an episode. Let's do what's happening in Vietnam right now with that particular rule that you can't go across that line, and you have to engage on this side. And let's put it into Star Trek." So they were taking news stories in every episode. And you could see them, and some people would get it, some people wouldn't. If NBC got it, they would fight it. But they were finding ways to talk about these things during entertainment primetime TV, which was not allowed.
And if I may just tag on something to that, speaking of stories, one thing that I learned as I was reading this book and recording this first book was Roddenberry was constantly bumping heads, not only with the network, but with the writers, really.
That's interesting. What were the issues that came up there?
Well, because Gene Roddenberry had a very strong, singular vision for what he wanted Star Trek to be. And a lot of these writers, some of them even very famous sci-fi authors of the time, and Roddenberry wanted them to write for his show because he knew it would add a legitimacy, right? And a respect to his show. And yet these authors would send him treatment ideas or screenplays, and then Roddenberry would rewrite them. And it would make them so angry. And early on, they were losing writers left and right because everybody was getting so angry that some famous author would turn in a screenplay, and Roddenberry and Justman would basically go, "Okay, thanks so much," and then they would end up rewriting it. Now, they would still give the writer the screen credit, but Roddenberry was notorious for rewriting many of the scripts that were submitted.
Yeah, one of the writers had a great quote that's in the book, and he said, "By the time it gets on the air, the only thing I recognize about my script is my name on the screen." And what's wonderful, too, is it's all illustrated in the books as well as the audiobook that Vic has done, because you're reading the actual letters from these writers and the responses in memos and letters from Gene Roddenberry and his staff. And Theodore Sturgeon really got into it with Gene Roddenberry, and Harlan Ellison really got into it.
Yeah, both very intense guys.
Yeah, and with these books, we just don't tell you about it. We just don't say it happened. We show it to you.
Oh, yeah.
Because you hear the actual memos. You read them in my books, or you hear them in Vic's audiobook, and so you're hearing the conversation, you're hearing the argument as if you are in the room.
Yes. You feel like you're sitting there with Harlan Ellison, with him expressing his anger and frustration. And you know what's interesting is, honestly, Whitley, I ended up doing the same thing with Star Trek Continues that Roddenberry did for his show. It's really an ironic parallel, because as I was reading these audiobooks and recording them, there were so many things that were going on with the original series, and I would just have to laugh out loud and think, we dealt with exactly that same issue when we made our series. And in my show, people would submit story ideas. I had hundreds of people submit story ideas. And if it was a good story or a good germ of an idea, we would have somebody write the screenplay. But then myself and some of my other producers like James Kerwin or Lisa Hansel or even Mark, we would go over these things and then I would script edit them to make them what I wanted it to be because it's my show.
Right, and that's exactly what Gene did.
Exactly. Star Trek was Gene Roddenberry's vision. And so he would get all of these stories and scripts and screenplays from different writers
If you do that to Harlan Ellison, he's going to basically go completely berserk.
Exactly.
Oh, and you know what?
Which he did, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
I asked Harlan, he would always get up on the table or get up on the person's desk. And he did that with Voyage to the Sea. I did a book on Voyage to the Sea, too, because I wanted to find out about Irwin Allen. And he would get up on the conference table and run down the table towards Irwin Allen to strangle him because they had changed something in his script.
Yeah.
And I asked him once. Nobody ever thought of asking him this. And I said, Harlan, every time you're telling a story or anything, you're always getting up on the table or getting up on a desk or whatever. Why do you do that? And he said, because I'm short, Mark. He said, how else am I going to intimidate these people? Well, Harlan was good at intimidating people, whether he got up on a table or not.
Yeah, short did not stop him.
Oh, he had such a wit, and he was so intelligent, and he could cut you to pieces. Well, you see that. You see that in these letters, and it's really interesting. But Vic is absolutely right. You know, every show has to have a visionary. It has to have a showrunner. And they got to do what they got to do because they're the only one who can really keep all those episodes feeling like they belong together.
Exactly.
They have Vince Gillian with Breaking Bad and stuff. But it's much easier today, not for Vic, because, you know, he wasn't able to pay them a lot of money and all that stuff. So he, you know, they're getting more wounded, where now you can buy them off. But now you have less episodes being made each year and bigger staffs and more time to make the episodes. Back then,
right. You
had to do 30 episodes a season, and so you had to bring in 26 freelancers. The staff is too busy rewriting scripts
right. To
write many of their own.
Right.
So it was just really a struggle.
Well, we have been on a fascinating voyage down the paths of Star Trek today, an unusual journey for Dreamland, but then again, I think it was a lot of fun, and if you do too, please let me know at whitley@streber.com. You can reach Vic at vicsworld.net. You mustn't miss StarTrekContinues.com. It's really very well done. Mark's website is markcushman.com. You can get his book from and the audio book from thesearethevoyagesbooks.com. That's thesearethevoyagesbooks.com. Thank you both very much for being with us this week on Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It was a dream. Thank you. It was a lot of fun.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Streber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Streber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.